Welcome to the 13th meeting in 2024 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to like to remind everyone to please switch off or put to silent the mobile phones and other electronic devices. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private? Moving on to agenda item number 2 today, we're taking evidence on the Judicial Factors Scotland Bill. For our first panel, can I welcome Mona Grandison, the Director of Interventions of the Law Society of Scotland, Gavin McCall, KC, the Faculty of Advocates, Dr. Alison McPherson, the Senior Lecturer in Commercial Law at the University of Aberdeen, and Professor Gareth Morgan of the Charity Law Association. Welcome, everyone. Can I remind the panel that to, first of all, not to worry about turning on the microphones because they'll be done automatically for you. And if you'd like to come in on a question, please just raise your hand or indicate to the clerks and that there is no need to answer every question. Simply indicate that this is not for you to respond to. However, please feel free to follow up in writing to any question after the meeting if you wish. So now we move to questions from the committee. So first of all, so good morning once again. Thank you for joining us. And before we do get into the specifics with relation to the bill, can you tell us briefly and in general terms what you think about the bill in front of us today? Mr. McCall.
Well, as I hope came across from the response that the Faculty of Advocates has submitted, we are broadly supportive of it. It appears to contain a lot of very helpful and useful ideas. The comments that the faculty has are largely things that we hope may assist to make things better from a technical perspective.
Thank you. Ms. Grandison.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome the opportunity today to address committee's questions, both as a representative of the Law Society of Scotland and as a practitioner who has taken on a series of appointments. The Law Society of Scotland is fully supportive of the Scottish Government's decision to implement the Scottish Law Commission's report and bring forward the piece of legislation. The present Judicial Factors Acts are outmoded and in need of substantial modernisation. This is a great opportunity to bring forward legislation which will be a useful tool for diverse groups in our society to resolve complex issues that affect their property and their lives. The proposed Judicial Factors Scotland Bill is a modernising act which could benefit from some further refinement in its drafting to ensure that it is future-proofed and that it's not too prescriptive to ensure it meets the needs of the users.
Thank you. And Dr. McPherson.
Thank you and good morning, Convener and the Committee. Very grateful for the invitation to speak to you today. Along with my colleagues, Professor Donna McKenzie Skeen and Dr. Ewan West at the University of Aberdeen, I very much welcome the Judicial Factors Scotland Bill. I think the Scottish Law Commission deserves a lot of credit for the work that they've done, and likewise the Scottish Government for taking this bill forward. Very pleased that the committee now has been given the opportunity to consider the terms of the bill. I would echo what has been mentioned so far. This is a bill that will seek to modernise the law. It's relatively outdated in various respects. And although judicial factories are not particularly common, they serve a very important function. You just have to look at the range of activities that are covered by judicial factors in the areas of law for which they're relevant, just to identify that. So yeah, very much welcome the bill. And yeah, it's a question of trying to make it as effective as possible and obviously to make sure that all stakeholders are heard in the process.
Yeah, thank you. And Professor Morgan.
Yes, thank you, Committee. I mean, we too, I'm here on behalf of the Charity Law Association, so we're only commenting on the aspects of the bill insofar as they relate to charities, but we too would welcome the bill. We agree the previous arrangements were pretty outdated, and we think this is a helpful way forward. We've just got a general comment, which comes up in various areas, about the need for more interaction between this bill and the Charities and Trustee Investment Scotland Act 2005.
And thank you very much. We're going to go over to Tim Eagle.
Good morning, everybody. I wanted to ask the Law Society about the procedures on the appointment of judicial factors in the case of missing people. In your submission to the committee, you set out that you were disappointed that reforms are not being taken forward in this area as you initially raised in 2019, that the current procedure is too cumbersome, prescriptive and restrictive. In his evidence last week, Mr. Layden of the Scottish Law Commission proposed that this could be improved in the way in which the Act is advertised in the guidance given to the citizens' advice bureaus and in court procedure? Would these suggestions achieve the reforms you want to see?
I think the Society would welcome clarification from the Scottish Government about how the new bill will improve the process for families of missing people. But I do agree with Patrick Leydon in his evidence to the committee that part of the issues are to debunk and not make the process terrifying for families in this area. So I think that having good advertising around the citizens' advice bureaus and the various law clinics about how you would deal with matters, and the accountant of court, I think their website plays an important role about detailing how the process works and how families can use it to best help them in these very difficult situations.
Moving on to charities then, I would like to ask the Charity Law Association about their concern that the bill is currently drafted, pays little regard to the role of judicial factors in the charity sector, and whether there are specific changes you would like to see made in the bill.
Thank you very much. Yes, I think our main concern is simply a risk of confusion that the Charities and Trustee Investment Scotland Act 2005 has this power in Section 34 for OSCA, the Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator, to petition the Court of Session to appoint a judicial factor to a charity. And it's worth saying that whilst the evidence you've had is, of course, that JF appointments are not that common, maybe about 7 a year, if one or two of those are charity cases, there may be as many as perhaps 20% of the appointments, so it's important to get it right. And it's just that so much of the bill seems relatively silent about this. The fact there is no specific reference to the 2005 Act at all is quite curious. We draw a parallel in our submission with the role in England and Wales, whereby the Charity Commission can appoint what's called an interim manager to a charity, which has a very similar role to a JF in Scotland. And there is a whole section of the Charities Act 2011 going over a page about how the interim manager is appointed and the powers that they have. And to be silent on so many of these issues, we just feel is a real recipe for confusion. In his evidence to you last week, Patrick Leydon, I think, suggested sort of like four places in the bill where some sort of cross-reference could helpfully be added. And although I haven't had time to consult with my colleagues on the Charity Law Association Working Party, I think those suggestions are very constructive. It's particularly important that when a JF is appointed to a charity, that they are there to exercise supervision of the charity in accordance with its charitable purposes and objects and has the normal duties of charity trustees. In particular, there's no specific statement about the JF's duty to report back to OSCA. They've got the responsibility to the accountant of the court, but in practice, in a charity case, it's really the supervision of OSCA that one would think would be rather more important. And there's also the question of consulting with beneficiaries. A charity, by law, exists for the public benefit, and therefore there will always be a wide class of beneficiaries. And you cannot consult very easily, usually, with individual beneficiaries. But there again, the supervision of OSCA is pretty important in that process.
Okay. Yeah. Anyone else want to come in? No. Sure.
Eminently reasonable to me. I noticed from a few of the responses there seemed to be questions about how the bill fits in with other pieces of legislation or other areas of law relating to judicial factors. So that seems like a reasonable suggestion to me.
Okay, thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you, convener. Thank you very much, guests. Can I just ask, it might be a bit of contention. Under Section 4 of the bill, the main qualification required to be appointed a judicial factor is that the court considers the person suitable for that role. So that's the court's decision. In response to the committee's call for views, some respondents, such as Missing People, supported this approach. Others, though, wanted the bill to be more prescriptive. Property Mark, for example, wanted professional qualifications to be specified in some circumstances. And the committee heard that the Scottish Law Commission's position is that the court is best placed to decide who is suitable for the role of judicial factor in a particular case. Anyone on the panel disagree that that is necessarily the way forward, or is it something different in the bill, that something that limits the court's discretion rather than as it stands? Please. Thank you. Gavin.
The faculty doesn't have any particular dog in the fight in terms of appointment. Traditionally, it hasn't been a role that people have come to members of the Faculty of Advocates to fulfil. What I would say is that trusting the discretion of the court is something that I would hope, and indeed I would personally believe, can be done by people. And I would also make this observation, when one is prescriptive about, for example, qualifications, almost inevitably situations will emerge that had been unforeseen, where that prescription will become problematic. If, as I say, the sheriff or the judge who is appointing is simply trusted to use her or his good discretion in the matter, that is, I would suggest, a sufficient check upon the need.
And Professor?
Yes, I would completely agree with Mr. McCall on that. And particularly in the charity cases, you might have a situation with a relatively small charity where there were nevertheless pretty serious issues and Oscar needed to seek the appointment of a judicial factor. And in those cases, if you would prescribe certain professions, that'd be quite limiting. I would draw a parallel with the role of an independent examiner of a charity. There are clear provisions under the Charities Account Scotland Regulations 2006 that a charity up to half £1 million income can have an independent examination of its accounts rather than a full audit. And the kind of criteria that's specified in those regulations about who could be an independent examiner, I would have thought would be quite appropriate for the choice of a judicial factor in the case of a charity of that sort of size.
Can I ask,
I'm just going to reiterate the point. I think it's just important to point out that what we're trying to achieve here is an enabling act that isn't too prescriptive, so that it allows the widest range of people to be appointed a judicial factor dependent on the circumstances for which the appointment comes about. The court will take all the circumstances into account about the reason for the appointment of the judicial factor and work out who might be the best person to be appointed. For instance, an individual experienced in farm management is probably the appropriate appointee in a partnership dispute in a farm, you know, for the running of the situation. A lawyer or an accountant sitting in Edinburgh is unlikely to be the most appropriate appointee in these kinds of circumstances, unless it's a specific accounting issue or legal issue. And it's the same for trust estates. You know, a trust and estate practitioner for the management of a deceased person's estate may be the appropriate person. So it's about keeping the legislation as agile as possible, I think.
And on that basis then, the court has made the decision as to who the judicial factor should be, looking into all the background of what the case is about and so on. But what if someone disagrees? Is it possible for anyone to challenge this at all?
Happy to take that. That has happened in the past, and the petitioners are invited to put forward an alternative individual if there is opposition by the parties that have been served with the petition, or they can nominate someone. Again, this is all a matter that rests with the court.
Okay, and obviously it has to actually progress. So once these elements of contention have been considered, then the court will make its final decision. Basically, yeah. Oops. Perfectly sensible. I think somebody's got to do it, I suppose, haven't they? You know, so, thank you for that. Thanks. Now, we understand that when a judicial factor is appointed by the court in relation to a solicitor or a firm of solicitors under the Solicitors Scotland Act, it's typically the Law Society's in-house judicial factor who is appointed In other words, it's the Society's Director of Interventions, yourself, I think, who appears on the panel today, and the Faculty of Procurators, beg your pardon, of Caithness, suggested that current system doesn't always work, and the judicial factor in these types of cases should always be wholly independent of the Law Society. So, Ms. Grandison, I think you'd be the first person to answer this one. Does the Law Society, do you, and anyone else who does have a comment, think that the current approach with an in-house factor is the correct one?
Yes, is the simple answer to that. I think it's important that this legislation is future-proofed as much as possible. So the proposed act should avoid, again, becoming prescriptive. So what is operational practice today in the Law Society is it may not be the case in 20 or 30 years' time. In terms of the Section 41 appointments made in terms of the Solicitor Scotland Act, the Society, as I say, can request the courts to make the appointment. They can nominate a suitable officer, and my name goes on most of those petitions. These appointments are one of the most important public protections available to the Law Society, as it fulfils its regulatory role. The petition is served on the parties with an interest, and those individuals are at liberty to object to the appointment or indeed nominate another officer to take on the appointment. As I've said before, ultimately the court will decide about these matters. So the proper checks and balances are in place. But the presence of the in-house team at the Law Society allows for the building of a team of experts who can deal with the public affected by the circumstances which brought about the appointment. This, with many other matters, was considered by the Scottish Law Commission, and they didn't consider that there was any mischief that needed to be addressed here.
So basically, it's about the necessity of a regulatory role which people can depend is going to take place, and that works. And that's it. Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Does anyone else want? Yes, Mr. Call.
Could I just make this observation? Certainly my understanding would be that if somebody could point to, in a particular set of circumstances, a particular reason why it was inappropriate, then that could be drawn to the court's attention and steps could be taken to have somebody that was out with even the function of the Law Society appointed as judicial factor. From my perspective, I would think that provides quite a useful check and a protection to people that have legitimate concerns that could come about. The other observation that I would make from the different branch of the profession that I am a member of is this. These matters do come before the Court of Session, so advocates see these things happening on a relatively, not a frequent basis, simply because there aren't frequent applications. But we are aware of them, and there is not a perception, I think, amongst any part of the legal profession, amongst the Faculty of Advocates, amongst the judiciary, so far as I'm aware, that this approach causes any difficulty of a practical or a substantive nature. Indeed, the general perception seems to be that it works perfectly well.
And that it actually gives comfort to those who are in these circumstances?
Well, absolutely. It is, I would have thought, a good thing for people to know that on the rare occasions where there are difficulties with solicitors' firms, that there is somebody there who has the skill and the expertise to step in and do something about it.
Thank you. That makes sense. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Thank you. So, obviously, in the likes of this legislation and much of the legislation that this committee looks at will be very technical in nature, and for the vast majority of the population, they might not fully engage with what actually happens in this committee. But now and again, there will be an incident that will happen that actually allows the legislation to become, you know, something that's quite real for many people. And one such incident was the collapse of the law firm McClure's and also various issues that have arisen from that. Something that I've taken a great deal of interest in because the company were based in my constituency. So to help the committee connect the bill to the real-life examples, can the Law Society explain why the judicial factor was not appointed to deal with the issues arising from McClure's in that case?
With regret, unfortunately, I can't discuss a specific case. And the committee will understand the reasons for that. However, I am happy to explain some background about the circumstances on which the Law Society would take a petition for the appointment of a judicial factor. In its own legislation, the Solicitor Scotland Act, they have specific powers to ask the court to appoint a judicial factor. The 1980 Act lays down the conditions under which an application in terms of Section 41 would be appropriate. If those tests are not met, the court will not appoint a judicial factor. The Society, as with any other party, have power to request the appointment of a judicial factor at common law. But to do so in these circumstances under the present legislation, the court would need to be persuaded that there's no alternative suitable remedy available in law. Additionally, the courts would be very reluctant to appoint a judicial factor where there was already in place another court officer, such as an administrator or a liquidator. And in some situations, the court may consider that the appointment of a liquidator or an administrator would be the most appropriate court officer to be appointed. It is also important to point out that regardless of the court officer that was appointed to a case, the issues all remain the same. The court officer duly appointed by the court, whether it's a judicial factor or an administrator or a liquidator, they have to dispose of the practice and find a solution for the problems. And in the case of obviously a legal firm, it would be a disposal to another regulated firm that is regulated by the Law Society of Scotland.
No, thank you for that. I appreciate obviously the challenge you have in terms of actually dealing with the firm, but certainly what you've said is now also on the record. I know it's something that has I've been approached by many solicitors from across the country who have expressed their concern, their anger with what's actually happened, because they feel as if it has it's had an adverse effect upon the wider sector, and clearly, obviously, fees will go up to pay for what's happened. But also, there has been a feeling that there has that the Law Society haven't fully explained the process as to why a judicial factor wasn't implemented and introduced at that particular point. But certainly, what you've said on the record may or may not appease some of the folk who have expressed their concerns and their thoughts to me. Certainly, going back onto the 1980 Act, the Law Society said in both its response to the 2019 Scottish Government consultation and also the committee's call for views that it would like additional powers to deal with, and I quote, incorporated practices, and thought that these could be adopted by way of amendment to the bill. And so, for the benefit of the record, what is the issues? What's the issue arising here, and what powers would the Law Society like to address it?
In the Society's response to the Judicial Factors Consultation of 2019, we identified a lacuna in the Solicitor Scotland Act 1980, which prevented the safeguarding of client funds in certain circumstances where an incorporated practice was involved. The Law Society is working with Scottish Government presently to resolve this lacuna in the new Legal Services Bill. However, it's envisaged that the drafting of the proposed judicial factors Scotland Bill at Part 1, Section 3, is now widely enough drawn so that when the bill is enacted, it will allow the Law Society to apply to the courts to safeguard client funds and property, should this be required in these types of cases. But hopefully it can be amended in the primary legislation in the Legal Services Act.
Thank you. Yes.
That issue, of course, about the legal form has often been a big issue with charity cases, but fortunately the 2005 Charities Act states clearly that OSCA may apply petition the Court of Session to appoint a judicial factor to a charity. It just says a charity rather than specifying particular legal structures, and therefore in the charity cases it appears there's no problem about the legal structure.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Faisal.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. In response to the committee's call for views, the Centre for Scots Law, University of Aberdeen, and R3 said that they thought the threshold for requiring caution in Section 5 is now set too high. Does the Centre for Scots Law want to explain its reasoning here, or does anyone else on the panel wish to comment on the policy merits of the proposed threshold?
Yes, I'm happy to comment in relation to this. I understand why there is a move away from requiring caution as a matter of course, and in every instance, or every the majority of instances. We think, however, that the threshold has been set in terms of the bill at a rather high level. Exceptional circumstances may not actually capture the policy intention here. I know as well that the Accountant of Court previously suggested that there may be professionals whose insurance policies wouldn't cover misuse of funds in the form of embezzlement, for example. And it's unclear whether, for instance, even outside the scope of professionals, the appointment of someone who is not a professional would meet the exceptional circumstances test. It could be addressed in a very simple way by taking out the word exceptional and replacing it with the circumstances, make it reasonable for caution to be required. Or another word like prudent could be used, or you could combine prudent with reasonable, for example, or proportionate would be another possibility. I think it would just be helpful for there to be greater scope for requiring caution in some instances. Another point we made as well is about what precisely would constitute caution. Ordinarily here we're talking about bonds of caution, but there may be other forms of guarantee, other forms of indemnity, consigning funds or other property with courts that could meet the test. So it may be a question of outlining some of the other possibilities, or indeed providing that the accountant of court or the court itself could determine the appropriate caution in a given instance.
I wonder if I might make two observations. First, a legal one, and second, a practical one. First, from the legal perspective, I would agree that exceptional circumstances is and should be seen as being a very high test indeed. In essence, it means what it says. And courts in particular are, in my view, likely to be very reluctant to see it as being anything other than very much an out with the norm situation. That may well be the policy decision that's taken, that is appropriate, but it should be taken on an eyes open basis. The second observation is the practical one, which is this. My understanding, and this is related to different situations in which caution is found, normally that's in the context of security for costs orders in court, is that pure bonds of caution, which has just been touched upon by Dr. McPherson, are now very difficult to source. Insurance companies, simply put, are reluctant, as I understand it, to offer these up. And so looking at what sort of security, and maybe looking to a broader concept of security, could be something that might serve a useful function on a practical level.
Just in a supplementary, just on that point, Is that something that you have seen a different sort of marked change in, say, over the last 10 years, 15 years, 20 years?
Yes. In practice now, in the Court of Session, certainly, which is my usual stomping ground, if I can put it that way, nowadays, where orders for security of costs are made, it would be very unusual for those to be fulfilled by way of a proper bondification. In other words, a contract with an insurance company that would have all of the hallmarks of such a thing. It is now much more common that either monies would be paid into the court or some other form of arrangement would be reached to provide the security. Now, I quite appreciate that's in a slightly different context than the one that we're talking about here, but it is indicative of what I understand to be a wider issue within the insurance market, if I can put it that way.
Is there a particular reason that this has happened?
My understanding is simply put that the insurance market does not really understand what these products are. They're seen as unusual. They are, I suspect, seen as being peculiar to a Scottish market and a Scottish form of legal cost security, and consequently the insurance companies themselves, simply put, don't feel that they want commercially to offer that up. That's my understanding of the situation, albeit I'm dealing at this in one stage removed as counsel. Solicitors may have a more direct view of whether or not that understanding is correct.
Thank you.
I think it's important to point out that the bondsification I carry simply cover me in the event that I actually steal the money that I'm managing. And that is obviously for the security of the estate and the account of court in making a finding against me that I have taken the money. Will ask the cationers to reimburse the estate. The cationers have an ability to then come after me and my assets for any of the money that has been so taken. So that, in the context of the Judicial Factors Bill, is what a cationary bond is talking about. I think that the Act has drawn this on a sort of risk-based approach to the issue. The account of court, it would be for them to address how many claims have ever been made against cationary bonds in the existence of, the Act over the last 50 years. I certainly have been working in this field for 40 of those years, and I'm aware of a couple of instances where claims against bondsification were actually made. But again, that's information you could get from the accountant of court about the reality of this. And I think the Act has taken a relatively pragmatic approach covering the issues about whether the marketplace is appropriate to respond to this, but again, I don't disagree that changing the word exceptional and putting it back to the court in the circumstances of the case, the court maybe will have information that helps them analyse the risk.
Thank you. Section 6 of the bill creates a new requirement that the notice of appointment of a judicial factor must be registered in an existing public register called the Register of Innovations. Is this a good policy approach, or can any of the panel see any difficulties with it? Are there any viable alternative approaches? Also, is it your understanding of the bill that an innovation is created via registration in the context of Section 6?
Thank you very much for this question. I think there are a few things here. I know that the Faculty of Advocates made a comment about the extent to which the Register of Innovations can truly be considered public in terms of, because of the difficulties in accessing it for members of the public and the costs that may be involved in that. I would concur with that. It's not public in the same way as, for instance, the company's register is, where you could just go online and quickly search for the details in relation to a company. But I will let Gavin pick that particular issue up in a bit more detail. I think it's a question of what precisely is the intention here. And you made the comment about viable alternatives, and that is the real difficulty, because perhaps you could devise a special register, but there would be costs involved in that and certain difficulties in establishing it. And at present, there doesn't seem to be a suitable alternative available. So this may just be the best under the circumstances, even though it doesn't quite meet all of the policy intentions here. In terms of the effect of registering in the Register of Inhibitions, the effect isn't entirely certain here. It could be interpreted as having the effect of an inhibition. An inhibition is essentially what's known as a form of diligence. So this is related to debt enforcement, and basically it places a limitation on a debtor from dealing with their heritable property, so land, buildings attached to land, and so on. It's not clear whether the intention under the bill is simply for this to be a method of providing publicity in a broad sense, or for this registration to actually carry the effect of an inhibition. Under the Bankruptcy Scotland Act 2016, there is an equivalent provision in relation to registration under Register of Inhibitions, which specifies that the registration of a warrant to cite in relation to sequestration has the effect of an inhibition. So it might be worthwhile, if the intention is for it to have the effect of an inhibition here, for the bill to contain some sort of similar provision to that.
Yes. Can I echo those comments? I think that's an important point to make, which is the Register of Inhibitions being chosen because registration should have effect as an inhibition, in other words, a restraint on somebody who's not the judicial factor making use of the property? Or is it just that the Register of Inhibitions is perceived as being a rattle bag style register that will just have to cope with this because there's nowhere else that's obvious for this to fit in? That second point was the wellspring for the observation made by the faculty on this point, which is this. If the idea behind this legislation, as I perceive it to be, is the commendable one of making things more open and more accessible to the public, then putting the registration into a register that is not the most readily publicly accessible place seems to the faculty to be a slightly odd decision. The other observation that we would make is this, that what registers are there to do in this case, putting aside the issue of whether it's to give rise to an inhibition proper, is to allow people to find out that a judicial factor has been appointed in a particular situation, because that will then inform what they do in terms of their interaction with the estate that's within the factory. And what the faculty took the view of on considering this matter was that, given the role that's been given to the accountant of court, that perhaps a more obvious thing to do would be for the accountant of court simply to maintain a register. Because in the circumstances, what a register is a list. And it doesn't have to be, bluntly, any more complicated than that for it to serve the function of giving the public notice. And so I simply would suggest, and the faculty has suggested, that that's something that we would suggest the committee may wish to consider moving forward. Would registration in the Register of Inhibitions actually serve the purpose that is intended?
Thank you, Mr. McCall. And Mr. Morgan.
Yes, a tiny addition from the charity's perspective. I confess I'd never heard of the Register of Inhibitions until I read this bill. In a charity case, of course, where people are going to be interested is to look at the Scottish Charity Register. And so long as, in a sense, the appointment is published there, as Oscar would normally do so under their inquiry powers, that seems to be sufficient. Now, my colleagues may want to argue that for consistency with other judicial factor appointments, it should still be appear in the Register of Inhibitions as well. But in practice, it will be the charity register will be the most relevant for most people.
So just on that point, would it be worthwhile actually for it to be registered in both?
I would, yes, I mean, I would have thought where a judicial factor appointed to a charity, you would want it registered obviously with OSCAR, I think they normally do that anyway because they have their power to publish inquiry reports, and as part of that they would tend to put something like this up, but perhaps a more explicit power might be useful. I'm just giving a personal comment there, sure. But clearly it needs to be consistent with other JF appointments.
Thank you. Ms. Anderson.
I think that this was part of what was wrestled with at the when the bill was being looked at, because it is this notion about where do you go to get the information? How does that information get out that a judicial factor is appointed? There is a well-established practice about in sequestration cases, about the register of inhibitions, and people are put on notice for due diligence and all the rest of it, that there is a court officer effectively appointed. And I think it was building on the back of that pre-existing, whether it's, you know, what it was meant for, the register of inhibitions, but at least it is somewhere where people will look and where we'll be concerned about if they try to deal with property that belongs to the person or the body that owns property, and it is a natural place to go for searching to deal there. So I think it was almost as simple as that, because I'm not clear that it is in everybody's consciousness that they would go to the account of court to look up to see if an estate was the subject of a judicial factory, because this is not a well-known bill, and the availability of that information. So I think it possibly was just a compromise on a register that was known to people for court officers.
Okay, no, thank you. Yes. Yeah, Dr. McPherson.
Yes, just picking up on that specific point, the register of inhibitions would ordinarily be looked at in the context of conveyancing transactions, so transactions relating to land belonging to a counterparty, the debtor, essentially. And of course, it may be the case that if this particular route is chosen and judicial factories are to be registered there, the practice of looking at that register may become wider, insofar as it wouldn't just be limited to conveyancing and connected types of transactions. But that is, of course, uncertain at the moment. Under the current practice, you wouldn't necessarily look at that register unless you are in the context of dealing with a conveyancing transaction or some other major transaction in relation to a party who you may think may have an entry on the register of inhibitions.
Okay, anything else, Faisal? Okay, yeah, Tim?
Just my apologies. I'm relatively new to this committee, so I'm trying to get my head around all of this. So am I picking you up right then? You're saying, your suggestion then is that it shouldn't be in that register because that register is already quite specific, but there potentially should be a new register where you can register a judicial factor. Or is that not what you're saying? You're saying the compromise is that it can be in this register, but it will make this register much wider in its concept.
I'm rather conflicted because I think in an ideal world, you would have a separate judicial factors register. And if it were very straightforward, simple to set up, little cost involved, then that would seem to be the preferable option. However, in the circumstances, this may just be the best compromise available.
Okay.
But what I would say is that there are certain limitations or issues with doing that. And it does somewhat broaden, of course, the scope of that particular register, which may change practices around it for good or bad. And, of course, we do, I think, need clarity as to what precisely the effect of such a registration in that register would be.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, well, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. And Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, convener. I want to move on and ask a new sort of series of questions, but in response to the committee's call for views, the Faculty for Advocates said it would be desirable to give the judicial factor the additional power to seek direction from the appointing court. When the Commission gave evidence to the committee, it seemed to suggest that there was already sufficient powers for the court in Section 11. Can the Faculty elaborate on what its proposed power would add to Section 11 of the bill? And do any of the rest of the panel want to comment on the desirability of an extra power for the court to give directions?
Mr. McCall.
First, the point from the perspective of the Faculty of Advocates about making it specific that there is a power to seek the court's guidance, in essence, on what a factor might do in a particular situation is that it's to give clarity to the position. It's not spelt out in Section 11. If one compares and contrasts it in particular with the situation that would pertain in relation to the law of trusts and trustees, where there is very well recognised powers to go to the court for such directions, one can certainly see people making an argument that the want of the specific power could be seen to be an indication that that specific power did not exist. Section 11 does make certain provision, but that is provision which is really aimed at things that can be foreseen at the start of the process. But what happens in the real world is that things come up during the course of a judicial factory that, simply put, haven't been anticipated. And that's perfectly understandable, because it's only once the factor is in and in office that they can understand the full issues that are before them. So in those situations, the perspective of the faculty would be that it would be desirable, as it has been and is regularly used in other areas of the law, for a factor who has a query about whether or not they can do something, rather than being in a position where they have to simply guess and then they could be subject to litigation after the event, can go to the court and say, can I do this or do I need to do something else? That simply clarifies the position and provides a relatively straightforward approach.
I don't want to kind of put you on the spot, but is it, do you have any specific examples, or is that something you could come back and give us so that we could go back to the commission or look at this with other witnesses? I guess it's just trying to find a specific circumstance where having the additional power would be helpful.
Well, the most obvious example is that this is a power that, in the context of the law of trust, which is a closely analogous area of the law, you're dealing with people holding property on behalf of somebody else, exercising a fiduciary capacity. That's what trustees do, just as judicial factors do, will on a regular basis find themselves in a situation where they are considering, do I have the power to do something? And they will regularly make application to the court to answer that question. So that's the most obvious example.
You know, I hear that point, but what I meant was, is there a practical example at the moment where the law around judicial where this is coming up in relation to judicial factors? Are there kind of examples either faculty have come across or others have come across that have suggested this, or is it just based on the law of trusts?
Well, what it is based around is the experience that unknowns crop up, and that is the approach of the faculty, is to look at a bill that's intended to future proof, to give the maximum discretion to parties to deal with things as they come up, rather than looking to say that what a bill should do is, as it were, retrospectively react to things that are known, to say, well, here is a power that would be available. If it's used, great. If it's not used, it provides no difficulty for anyone.
Okay, no, that's fine. I mean, I guess the sort of tricky thing is we've got the person who was sort of involved in driving the bill forward and drafting it, saying that there isn't a problem, and that this is already catered for. So I guess it's just trying to work out whether that really is needed, and if there aren't specific examples of where it's needed at the moment, then it's harder to push back and say Section 11 doesn't cut it. That's why I was asking.
Well, certainly, but as I would read Section 11, and this is the point that I was seeking to make, that's really looking at things at the start of the process rather than during the course of the process. And it's during the course of the process where unknowns can crop up.
Dr. McPherson, you wanted to come in?
Yes, I mean, perhaps unsurprisingly, as an academic, I don't have practical examples to draw upon here, but I would agree with the points that were made by Gavin. When I was reading through the Faculty of Advocates' response to the call for views, I found myself nodding in agreement with the suggestion that it would be wise for there to be a provision along the lines that are suggested. I mean, it's commonplace, as was indicated, that issues do arise in the course of a judicial factory and indeed in analogous situations such as where trustees are involved. So I think just giving that clarity would be helpful, and there's certainly no harm in including specific provision on the matter.
Thank you. Ms. Anderson?
I hear what has been said by other parties. However, noting the comments made by the Scottish Law Commission and their evidence, there are ways for factors to seek comfort and direction from the court through a return to court for powers or seeking the advice of the accountant of court. I think the slight difference here is that it's anticipated by the Act that the judicial factor is a decision maker. And that was pointed out by the Law Commission and their evidence, that it is for them to make decisions on the specifics. It varies slightly from a trust situation, because a trust is a long and enduring situation, whereas often judicial factors are put in for a specific purpose to do a specific thing, and the court have entrusted them to actually carry through that. And so when petitioning, you will want to give thought to, but certainly I've not found a difficulty that if there was a real issue that I couldn't go back to court at a later date to get some powers if I felt that the power bank that I had was deficient. And in fact, one of the good things about the Act now is that it actually clarifies the powers. In the past, I have been, going back to the Act of Suderin of 1700 somewhere, which are not really clear to any of us what the powers are, but the Act obviously clarifies these, and you can ask for the suite of powers that you think may be needed in the course of events.
Okay, thank you. Professor Morgan.
Just a tiny point to add context from the charity perspective. I don't disagree with anything my colleagues have said. In practice, of course, in a charity case, one would expect that the judicial factor can exercise the normal powers of a charity trustee to approach OSCA for consent to do something. And so on a practical level, I think it's much more likely that they would be approaching OSCA for consent on these things. In particular, quite often in a charity, you'll want to go through some kind of scheme of reorganisation, which is already allowed for in Chapter 5 of the 2005 Charities Act. Whilst I think there may be occasions when a charity JF may want to go back to the court, it's worth noting this is another reason why we need a bit more in the Act, in the Bill, about the interaction with the powers of OSCA.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Oliver?
Thank you, Convener. We've talked a bit in the course of the last question about similarity with the law around trusts. Section 17 of the Bill covers the investment power of a judicial factor in respect of the estate. And I wondered, following the approach in the Trust and Succession Scotland Act, did panellists think it should be on the face of the legislation that a judicial factor could choose to invest in ethical, social or governance-tested investments, even if these might not lead to maximum income for the estate?
Yes, Dr. McPherson.
Yes, I think that is a reasonable suggestion. I certainly don't think it should be mandatory for a judicial factor to have to make such an investment. But certainly I can understand why there may be a desire for there to be consistency with trust, especially because the Trust and Succession Act has recently been passed. And I know that there is an intention to some extent to uncouple judicial factors from trusts, but they are analogous in various different respects. And judicial factors may even be viewed as a special type of trust relationship. So certainly I wouldn't be against the idea of including provision along the lines that you're suggesting. And for the sake of consistency with the Trust and Succession Scotland Act 2024, that may be advisable to adopt that particular course. I know that in the previous evidence session, there was a suggestion that judicial factories are often significantly shorter, and it may not be wise to put in place the same provisions that exist in relation to trustees, which are often rather longer. But in our response to the call for views, we managed to include data we'd received from the accountant of court, which showed that even though on average in recent years there were only about 7 or 8 judicial factories, at the end of last year there were 42 live cases, which does indicate that a number of these are going on for a considerable period of time. There may also be situations in which there have already been investments that constitute part of the estate that are in, that have had non-financial considerations that are part of the decision-making process, and there may be the need for reinvestment by judicial factors. So as a result, I would say that it would be reasonable to at least allow, if the circumstances justify it, for non-financial concerns along the lines of ESG, or I think it's ethical, social and environmental that's in the 2024 Act to be considered.
Thank you. If anyone else want to come in on this particular point? Yes, Ms. Anderson.
The Law Society was in favour of this proposal in the Trust and Succession Act.
Thank you. Thank you. Oliver?
Thank you. I wanted to go on now and ask the Centre for Scots Law at the University of Aberdeen and Professor Greer at Aberdeen University, as well as R3, have all said that the fiduciary nature of the judicial factors duties needs to be spelled out explicitly in the legislation. The Commission seems open to this to some extent, if stated as a general principle rather than as a detailed treatment of the topic. What does the Centre for Scots Law think of the Commission's view, and what do the rest of the panel think of the views expressed so far on this topic?
Dr. McPherson.
Thank you. I suppose there are different approaches that can be taken here. To some extent, if you were to add something as simple as in, for instance, section 10.1, where it states, it's the general function of a judicial factor to hold, manage, administer and protect the factory estate as a fiduciary, for not quite abracadabra, but as a fiduciary is somewhat similar to that. So somewhat magic wording. It helps to clarify the position. The Scottish Law Commission in their report were rather clear that they view a judicial factor as a fiduciary as, for instance, a trustee is. But there are no specific duties in here in relation to matters like conflicts of interest. If you look at the Companies Act 2006, by way of comparison, directors of companies are also fiduciaries. And in there, it's spelled out far more clearly the specific duties in relation to matters like conflicts of interest that directors owe to a company. I wouldn't necessarily expect, given how the bill is at the moment, for lots of different duties to be inserted, but if you had something as simple as stating that they are acting as a fiduciary, that would help at least to make reference to some of the existing law on the matter and to make it clear that, because if someone were to look at this provision, they might scan down, having looked at section 10.1, and see section 10.3, and it just refers to exercising care, prudence and diligence and taking professional advice when appropriate. It doesn't seem as high a standard as you would want from someone in a fiduciary capacity. In the Companies Act 2006 as well, it does also state that in terms of most of the duties in there, the general duties of directors are fiduciary. And in there it states that in terms of their enforcement, they can be enforced in the way that other fiduciary duties can be. So maybe something along those sorts of lines would be appropriate as well. I noticed that the bill does shy away from using duties. Instead, it wraps up duties and powers into functions, which I think is okay. But I think it would be helpful to have something a bit more explicit about the fiduciary nature of a judicial factor.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else like to come in?
I don't think I disagree with anything that's been said on that.
Just to add the point, keep making the charity cases, of course, this interacts with the existing requirements on charity trustees and the explicit statement that the judicial factor has the powers and the duties of the trustee would be helpful, I think, on this.
The faculty had no strong view. This was not something that we perceived. The reason for it is that reading this Act as a whole, as one should do, I would not have thought there's any doubt but that a judicial factor would be seen as someone exercising a fiduciary function. Consequently, it's not entirely clear to me what simply spelling that out for the sake of spelling it out achieves. And I am always slightly conscious that in attempting to spell something out, you can somehow draw lines that weren't intended to be there. So that's the simple note of caution. If it can be done well, it does no harm. But it's unclear to me that any person looking at this from a technical perspective, I would have thought would see this as being a fiduciary role in any event.
Okay, and certainly with that, bearing in mind, I mean, this is quite a, it's a small number of individuals who will be practising this, so they will be expert in this area of law. Okay. Yes, Dr. McPherson.
Yeah, just a very quick follow-up on that. So I mentioned, of course, the Companies Act 2006 and the provisions within there, but also within the Trust and Succession Scotland Act, there are various places in which fiduciary is expressly mentioned, so that may be something to consider as well, given the connection between judicial factors and trustees.
Good. No, thank you. Thank you. Oliver?
I know, I'm happy with you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks. Okay. And Bill Kidd.
Thanks again, convener. Judicial factors, we're to some degree been talking about them as if, you know, they're all queuing up outside the door waiting to get a job or something, that sort of thing. But the Faculty of Advocates and the Sheriffs and Sheriff Summary Sheriffs Association have both said that the Section 23 of the bill could be modified to deal with exceptional circumstances when a judicial factor has acted unreasonably in a situation not covered by Section 24, so should be found personally liable for legal costs in that circumstance. The Commission wasn't certain that this suggested modification was the correct approach to take and feared that judicial factors would become unduly preoccupied with their own risk of personal liability in these circumstances, potentially. Does anyone actually think on the panel that the Commission's position on the issue is the correct one to take, or that it would even actually be something that's an issue at all?
Can I simply make this observation that if the concern is that people would be somehow worrying about the fact they might be personally liable, the proposal made by the faculty would be that in exceptional circumstances where people had essentially done something wrong, and in the most situations would have done something wrong knowing that they were doing something wrong, that they should potentially, if the court deemed it appropriate, be found personally liable. Simply put, why would it be fair for the people properly entitled to benefit from the estate have to carry the cost of somebody who had possibly knowingly done something wrong? I would be surprised if that concern, which is something that's pretty standard across large swathes of the law of Scotland, would put people off from fulfilling that function.
Ms. Anderson?
I think that the comments made by Scottish Law Commission in this area are very relevant. I mean, if a factor follows the process of seeking advice and consulting with the accountant of court, I'm not really clear why his actions in taking a case to court would be subsequently found as unreasonable. Obviously, if there is evidence that the sheriff found that the factor had lied to the court about something that had happened or something like that, the sheriff can bring that point to the accountant of court, and a decision can be taken by the accountant on whether the estate has suffered loss here. So I think that there is a process, that already exists for people to make complaints about a factor's behaviours. And so I think the safeguards in the bill are already okay.
From what's been said, it would seem to be an unlikely scenario anyway, but should such a thing happen, it's actually covered already anyway. Is that right?
That's my view.
Yeah. Okay.
There are still avenues to be brought through by bringing it to the attention of the accountant, of course.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you. And Tim.
Yes, thank you. So moving on to Section 34 and 38 of the bill. So if I've got this right, Section 34 of the bill deals with discharge of the judicial factor, and Section 38 deals with the accountant's investigation powers. Now, the Centre for Scots Law, I think you made comment on the interrelationship between these two and whether that was set right or laid out right within the bill. Now, the Commission came back and explained that And I was a wee bit confused by this myself. Section 38 could apply first before Section 34. To me, that didn't quite explain how it would work in the opposite way round, if that makes sense, where you were discharged and then something came to light. Could yourself, Alistair, or anybody else on the panel want to shed light on the interrelationship between those sections?
Yes, I think I had some of the same confusion in relation to that as you did. And the point you've just made is exactly what we had in mind. I suppose there are a few things to pick up on here. First of all, in Section 34, it specifies that the judicial factors accountability ends upon their discharge, except where they have incurred criminal liability. And we wonder whether that captures everything that we want it to, because criminal liability is sometimes quite difficult to achieve. There may be problems in terms of actually successfully prosecuting someone in relation to criminal matters. Presumably, this also includes civil liability arising in relation to that criminal liability, but that is not spelled out, maybe implied here. But I'm thinking of instances like the serious misuse of funds or other property in the estate. So fraud. Fraud, of course, is not just criminal. You can have civil law fraud. The circumstances might not be enough for the criminal version, or indeed there's not enough for a successful prosecution, but there might be enough for it to constitute civil law fraud. If you look in the Bankruptcy Scotland Act 2016, in terms of the discharge of a trustee in sequestration, liability will continue if there has been fraud. It doesn't limit it to the criminal form of fraud. So that would be the first point to make. And then the next one is, as you were suggesting, the relationship between Section 34 and 38. Imagine a situation where discharge has taken place, but prior to that, there was fraudulent behaviour by a judicial factor, but maybe not enough for it to be successfully prosecuted as criminal conduct. And it only comes to light after discharge. It's not clear to us, when you look at Section 38, whereby the Accountant of Court has the ability to investigate, and then if there's serious misconduct, to pass that on to the court, whether that is stopped from happening by virtue of the discharge. So imagine you have this behaviour by way of fraud before discharge, it only comes to light afterwards. Is Section 38 and its operation precluded by virtue of the discharge? That is not clear to us. I think that should be clarified. If it is the intention for Section 38 to continue to operate in those circumstances, there could be a provision made for that, so it could be without prejudice. So Section 34 could be without prejudice to the operation of Section 38. You could seek to limit it where discharge has taken place in terms of how Section 38 operates. If it does apply, Section 38, that is, then the court may dispose of the matter in whatever manner it considers appropriate. But as we mentioned in our response to the call for views, and as you suggested, it isn't entirely clear how these sections operate in tandem with one another. And there is also this question about whether Section 34 is drafted in the most appropriate way.
Any other comments on that?
No.
Okay, I agree with you. Fair enough. Thank you.
Okay, no, thank you. So in response to the committee's call for views, the Faculty of Procurators of Caithness said that it thought that there should be a specific procedure for an interested person or organisation to raise concerns about the judicial factors management of the estate. This proposed would first be to the accountant, and if unsatisfied with the outcome, there would then be a role for the court. When the Commission appeared before the committee last week, it was decidedly unsure about the policy merits of this idea. Now, what does the panel think of this as a proposal, and for the benefit of the committee, can you identify any benefits and also drawbacks to the suggestion? Ms. Anderson.
I think the Society shares the Scottish Law Commission's views expressed in their evidence session. It's very unclear about the mischief that's been complained of here. The factors' role is complex and a difficult one. They are very closely scrutinised in all their actings by the Accountant of Court's Office. This is done annually through the accounting process and in relation to any major activities through the management plan or as a result of regular contact with the Accountant of Court's Office. where the factor and the accountant will discuss in detail the steps that a factor will take to address issues arising in a case, and the factor will report on the outcomes that they've uncovered. The very nature of the appointments requires a factor to balance a number of competing priorities and interests. There's no question that the decisions taken by a factor can be contentious with some parties who may have an interest in the estate. However, there are numerous safeguards in place within the Act which allows people to raise concerns. There's no evidence that the existing system of raising concerns is not working, and any additional burden and legislative process that's added to the Act is likely to simply deter people from taking on the appointments and therefore reduce the effectiveness of the legislation.
No, thank you. Anyone else? Yes.
Just to give some charity context on that, I mean, it is quite common for people to complain about how charities are being run in these circumstances. As we know, the number of judicial factor appointments to charities in Scotland is still relatively small, but certainly by parallel with the England and Wales regime of interim managers, it's not at all unusual for people to complain that the interim manager is taking vast resources out of the charity and not really doing very much, or that they're closing down projects that could perfectly well have continued, and therefore the beneficiaries of the charity are losing out. In practice in England and Wales, the people then normally try and raise their complaints with the Charity Commission, who have directly appointed the interim manager. And it would be sensible, in a sense, if we could do the same arrangement, that people could draw their concerns to OSCA, because there's a kind of implied role of OSCA's supervision of the judicial factor, but in terms of the fact that OSCA is seeking the appointment of the judicial factor. But some more direct accountability on those lines would, I think, be helpful. Obviously, in the extreme case, somebody in Scotland who's concerned about a charity judicial factor could go back to the court, but you don't really want them to have to do that except as a last resort.
Anyone else want to come in on this? Yes.
Just to say those points seem fair to me. Also, as a member of one of the Law Society of Scotland's committees, I should probably not dissent from what Morna has said, so I will leave it there.
And Mr. McCall, have you got any? No. Okay, no, thank you. And so just before we do close, so over the last 10 years, the accountant in court has registered 77 new cases. And of these, 44 have now been concluded, with the average case length of 37 months. And the median length of a judicial factor's appointment over the period is 31 months. Now, with this bill, if this bill does go through the parliamentary process, amended or otherwise, do you think this legislation would actually make that process quicker or longer, or do you think there might actually be more judicial factors actually implemented as a consequence of the bill?
Say very briefly, I would imagine there might be a very modest increase in the usage of the law of judicial factors as a result. I think in the documentation accompanying the bill, it was suggested it's anticipated maybe about 12 per year in total would commence, as opposed to 7 or 8 at the moment. I mean, it doesn't seem unreasonable to suggest that might be the case. I mean, in terms of efficiency, if you have the clarity that this bill seeks to provide, then you would imagine it would make the process a bit more efficient. I wouldn't be able to put any sort of timescale in terms of how much quicker an individual judicial factory would take, but I would imagine there may be some sort of a modest improvement.
Okay, thank you. And Ms. Gunderson?
I think the intention of the legislation, by clarifying the role of the factor and the powers, etc., will make it much more amenable to resolve issues. I know from practical experience, you know, that people talk about the potential of appointing a judicial factor, and everybody balks at the thought of it, because it's sort of, you know. But this bill would demystify the process and how it would work, and people will be able to see how they could actually practically use this. And of course, the whole point was to speed up the process, to sort of say and impose solutions for difficult problems, and allow a decision maker to make decisions and move on. And so hopefully it will reach that aim. I did some analysis of my numbers, and just for the committee's information, my cases on average take 4.5 years to complete, but I've always tried to get that into a shorter period of time, but invariably there's always things that crop up and prevent it for us moving them on as fast as we would like. But as I say, hopefully the bill will achieve these aims.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, I think if the process can be simplified as the bill proposes, then it, certainly that it would be possible to consider more judicial fact appointments to charities. As you probably gathered, OSCA would generally consider it very much a last resort step only in the most serious cases. One small point that perhaps we could just make in the Charity Law Association submission, we did just query why it is that OSCA can only appoint a judicial factor by going to the Court of Session, whereas, as Mr. McCollum mentioned, in other cases, the bill allows for a sheriff court to make the appointment. And we, although we haven't heard from OSCA on this issue, we do query why that that isn't allowed in charity cases.
Thank you. And Ms. McCall.
What I would say is this bill certainly won't make judicial factories take any longer. Will it encourage more judicial factories? Possibly, simply because it will give publicity, possibly within the legal profession more than anything else, to the fact that factories are there as a measure that can be imposed, a measure that can be used in certain practical circumstances. What I would say, however, is that the perception, whether this is right or wrong, within my branch of the profession, certainly, and I'm putting to one side and taking out of this the Law Society, solicitors, judicial factories, which I think are a class unto themselves, is that judicial factories can be expensive, and that is a reason why people tend to shy away from them. And now, that is a perception, but perception can often drive what remedies people go on to seek. This bill does not, and indeed cannot, address issues of cost, because they will be wholly dependent upon the individual circumstances of any factory. So there's nothing other than, I would have thought, good stuff in the intent behind this. I would not have thought that it is likely to drive a massive explosion in the amount of digital factories, nor should it, frankly.
Okay, well, thank you. Tim?
Just one comment, just to the Professor Morgan, just on the charities. Are we, and potentially to us as well as a committee, are we content that we've got your wish list, if you like, in your previous submission and what you've said today? Have you sort of put through everything you would like to see within this bill for the charity sector, or is that something you could potentially write to us, you know, just really detailing exactly what it is you would probably like to see based on some of your comments today?
Yes, I think that's a very helpful question, Mr. Eagle. We've given some general indications in our submission, and I think what Patrick Layden said to you last week about he raised four specific sections where he felt some interaction might be useful. So if we could respond further on to that in writing, that'd be very welcome.
That's okay, isn't it? Yeah. Perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So in terms of the panellists, are there any further comments that you would like to put on record? No? Okay. My colleagues, any further final questions? No. Okay, so with that, thank you very much to the panellists for your time this morning. And certainly if there is anything further that you would like to inform the committee of after today, please do so in writing. And once again, thank you very much for your time. So with that, I'll now suspend the session briefly to have a change of panel, but also have a very short comfort break. Okay, thank you very much. And for our second panel today, can I welcome Mona Grandison, the Director of Interventions and Law Society of Scotland, Sandy Lamb, the partner in Lindsay's, and also Ken Patullo, the partner at Begbie's Trainer. And first of all, can I remind the panellists to, first of all, not to worry about turning on the microphones because they'll be done automatically. And if you'd like to come in on any question, please just raise your hand or catch the eye of the clerks. And but there's no need to answer every question, simply indicate that it's not for you. However, if you do want to follow up in writing afterwards, then please do so. So we'll now move to questions from the committee. So first of all, thank you for agreeing to appear before us today. It's certainly very helpful for the committee to get the views of those practising as judicial factors. And for the benefit of the committee, can you describe the type or types of judicial factories that you're currently and have been involved in, and specifically what, in general terms, are the purposes of your appointment, and for how long have you been in post, and do you usually find yourself in post? And how did you initially become to be appointed as a judicial factor by the court? Mr. Lamb.
My experience as a judicial factor is, I suspect, in the context of those with whom I'm on the panel, relatively limited. However, I am a partner with a legal firm where we deal with a number of trusts and executories, and the judicial factories I'm presently involved in, there are two. Both have analogies to the working of a trustee, I would say. The first came about because of a dispute between two executors, which was completely unresolvable for a number of reasons, and one chose to petition the court for the appointment of a judicial factor, and it was suggested that I might be, as an independent lawyer with some experience of executory and trust work, that might be appropriate for me to deal. And the second involves a situation where there is a deceased chap, and for reasons that remain unclear, there's no one willing to stand up and act as executor there, but there are obligations and indeed benefits for his estate in having someone appointed. So that's broadly the background of my involvement. Both of these are ongoing, so I can't say how long they should take, but I would say one is well into its fourth year. The other is less than a year old.
Thank you. And Mr. Patullo.
I would say all of mine have been, all with one exception, which was many, many years ago. But perhaps with hindsight, it should have been a straightforward bankruptcy. It was a petition to the court in respect of somebody, and there was a considerable contention in relation to the estate. But all the recent ones certainly have been in relation to partnerships, where there's been some sort of a reason why the partnership could not continue. There was one of my recent ones was just pre-COVID. I say recent, that's obviously 5 years ago, I appreciate, but it was relatively recent. And what had happened was that both the current partners had been made bankrupt. One of the partners had then been hospitalised for several years and was therefore unable to deal with anything. So the partnership, by definition, had effectively terminated. So the decision was reached, and there was confusion also about whether or not about which partnership actually subsisted. To give you an idea, this is a farming partnership dating back over 100 years, and all the original partners had died, and then the subsequent partners had then become partners. So the decision was reached that a judicial factor was the best way forward to deal with the partnership estate in order to prevent a fire sale of the farm. On a balance sheet basis, the partnership estate was still completely solvent, albeit the individual partners were clearly not. But if enough funds could be made available from the partnership estate to pay off the bankruptcy, then which was of course what eventually happened, then that was deemed to be a good thing, and so judicial factor was the way forward. Another recent one was an interim judicial factor appointment, which did not actually ever proceed to a full judicial factor, because once we had been in office for, again, this dragged on for about 18 months, the partners eventually, I think, came to their senses and decided that a sensible thing would be just to reach some sort of agreement about how the partnership should actually proceed. And the most recent one, to which I've not actually been appointed yet, but I'm expecting to be appointed, was we were contacted by a firm of solicitors up in either Orkney or Shetland, I can't remember which, where a partnership and the relations had just completely broken down between the partners, but clearly the partnership assets still needed to be dealt with, and the partnership itself carried on in some sort of way. So that's certainly my experience of judicial factors anyway.
Well, thank you very much. And Ms. Gunderson.
Well, thank you once again. I'm appearing here as a practitioner. I've got 30 years' experience in the role as the in-house judicial factor for the Law Society of Scotland. I've got, as I said earlier, 57 appointments under my belt, and that covers in approximately 100 estates. The appointments in terms of Section 41 of the Solicitor Scotland Act are relatively unique in that they arise from the situation where there's been a breach of the accounts rules and there's a shortfall on the funds held for clients, or in situations where the books and records are in such a mess that it's impossible to know the financial position of the firm. Or it is anticipated that a claim may arise on the Client Protection Fund. In all such cases, I take over the management of the firm, and the first job that I'll be engaged with is to try to find a solution for the firm and its clients to minimise the disruption so far as we're able to do so, and ensure that the remaining client funds and papers are protected. In most cases, we would seek to pass the firm on to a new firm of solicitors because we're unable to provide legal services to clients and we can't complete their transactions. Having secured the disposal of the practice, we would work closely with the acquiring firm to resolve the client issues that gave rise to the appointment. In the first instance, if there was a situation where the client account was short as a result of theft by a practitioner, we would work with the client to evidence their loss and assist them and their new solicitors with the processing of the appropriate claims. If the situation arose because the accounting records were poorly kept, we would work to reinstate the records while working with the new firm to assist and ensure, where possible, that clients aren't prejudiced by the circumstances that they find themselves in. Ultimately, I would report the detailed outcome of the investigation, and in particular, should any criminal activity have taken place, I will report to the police and work with them as they pursue the party or parties involved. As part of the process of dealing with the cases, we'll pursue the debts of the firm and settle the claims from the clients, from the monies held on the client account. We'd seek to recover whatever assets are available to us. Particularly, we're looking to recover assets where theft has occurred. In many cases, the appointments can extend to the personal estates of the solicitor, and we would recover money from their personal assets where possible. I can be involved in extensive litigation in relation to my cases, and these can take a number of years to get resolved. We work very closely with the master policy insurers of the firm, intimating claims when received from clients of the firm, and providing the evidence to the insurers that will help them settle the claims. Once all the client claims have been paid and the debts and gathered, as far as we're able to do so, the assets recovered and the ordinary creditors paid, though that is most unusual in most of my cases, and the reporting is concluded, I'll wind up the case and apply for my judicial discharge. And I think I said to you in my earlier evidence session, On average, my cases take about 4.5 years to conclude.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Oliver Mundell.
Hi, thank you, Convener. The Commission believes that the proposed reform of law and judicial factors was an ideal area for the law reform project for the Commission, and furthermore that it's an extremely worthwhile one. I've listened carefully to what the panellists have said around their experience. Do you agree that this is a worthwhile area of reform, and in terms of your previous experience, what practical difference would the new legislation make to you when you're operating as a judicial factor?
Ms. Gunderson?
Yes, so as I stated earlier, this is a modernising bill. It's easy to read and understand the relevant processes arising from a judicial factors appointment. It clearly sets out the powers and duties I alluded to this morning, that, you know, the ordinary powers of a judicial factor in the present acts go back to acts of sedering. So people understand what a factor can and cannot do by this new bill. In the past, it was a question of going back to the well-developed case law, which is fine if you've got a good memory as to which case gave you the power to unlock lock-fast places, but it's not so great if your memory's sort of failing like mine occasionally. The most important aspect of the bill is that it is enabling legislation which allows the factor to develop innovative solutions to complex problems and propose solutions so to the interested parties, and then be able to take them through and implement them and go to court for sanction to do that.
And Mr. Lamb.
Yes, I certainly think it's important to modernise the law. I can't disagree with anything that Ms. Grandison has said. My personal experience and that of my colleagues, both within and without my firm, I would say that although those of us in the sort of trust and estate community in Scotland, generally speaking, know fine what a trust and an estate and the powers of a trustee are, there's a number of colleagues who, although they have an idea of what a judicial factor is, they don't really know the detail at all. And therefore, this can only be a good thing to modernise it, make it clear what the powers are, what the powers aren't, and have a modern way of administering, and so that everyone understands exactly what can and can't be done.
And Mr. Petula.
Yes, I entirely agree. It's a good thing. This is the first time I think there's been any new legislation in relation to this for over 130 years. So I think that's all to the good. It's, I think in terms of how we carry out our duties as judicial factors, it's kind of almost just really just sort of doing the right thing. Just thinking in terms of my experience anyway, you know, as I say, it's mainly been in relation to partnerships. So you would you know, secure the assets, get in all the assets, and just think generally about what the what should be done with those assets, obviously in conjunction with the accounting of court as well. So I think, yeah, it's entirely a good thing that this this bill is being brought in, and the whole legislation in relation to this is being updated.
And Oliver Mundell.
Thank you. I wanted to go on and ask about section 12 of the bill in relation to the information gathering powers for judicial factor. There is an exception to the requirement to comply. This is for the UK or for UK government ministers and departments and bodies exercising reserved functions such as HMRC. It may be the case that a Section 104 order ultimately extends the full scope of the information gathering powers to UK government ministers, departments and bodies, but obviously we're not sure if that will happen yet. If this issue doesn't get addressed via a Section 104 order, does this present any problems for you? And if so, how significant are those potential problems?
Mr. Petula.
To be honest, I can see no real reason why the information gathering power should not extend to everyone. The vast majority of what I do relates to insolvency of companies and bankruptcy of individuals. We have significant information gathering powers in relation to that, so I would like to see those information gathering powers brought into line with judicial factors. I can see no reason why anyone should be able to say, I'm sorry, I'm just not going to give you that information.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Lam?
Yes, again, referring to my experience in dealing with deceased estates, an executor stands in the shoes of a deceased and has all the rights to the information the deceased would have had. That is in and of itself essential for carrying out the duties of an executor in dealing with an estate. If a judicial factor is to deal with all of the matters that affect the judicial factory estate, then it's hard to do so without having access to the information. I confess I'm not completely au fait with what would and would not be available under Section 12, but I would broadly agree with Ken that it ought to be as broad as possible.
Thank you. And Ms. Grandison.
I think, from what I've described as the work that I need to do, I mean, speed is of the essence, and securing assets and understanding what is going on in the estate, the liabilities, etc. And certainly getting cooperation from government departments is essential as part of the process. We've had very significant difficulties in the past in dealing with HMRC and managing to get information, and eventually we had to go to the solicitor's office in Scotland, the problem being that the HMRC's legislation does not recognise a judicial factor and therefore did not consider they were a party that they could disclose information to. That has now been dealt with by the solicitor's office, and we've got a good relationship with them, and they obtain the information, understanding the nature of the appointment and the requirement for disclosure in order to help us fulfil the functions, understand what has gone on. Etc. So I think where government departments do hold material information, and that might not just be HMRC, but it could be in many different departments, depending on the circumstances of the case, having them comply with requests for information from a factor is going to be material in getting the speed at which we need to act and deal with matters resolved. And so the notion of an optional, giving the information to the factor is difficult to understand from the legislation. And I think the other point about it, again, is just the cost of continually writing back and forth to people, whilst they're thinking about it is the main problem that we find, not just in the sense that if we need to secure assets or there are funds available and them arguing over the rights takes money and time and can delay the administration significantly.
Well, thank you. Just before I bring Oliver back in, So just on the HMRC point, obviously you gave it an example there, Ms. Grandison. Are there any other departments where there have been some challenges and delays in terms of getting information from?
I at one stage had to contact the Ministry of Defence for some information as a result of the appointment. Again, there was a lot of problems about dealing with that. We found a workaround, but it's the time and cost of finding workarounds.
Oliver?
So I was going to ask, just for clarity, you'd be very keen then to see the Section 104 order. Is that what I'm taking from what you're saying?
Sorry, I didn't fully...
I was taken from what you're saying then that you'd be very keen to see a Section 104 order.
Indeed, yes.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely.
Thank you. And then, Convener, if it's okay, I'll go on to the next question, which also relates to Section 12 of the Bill, which, again, states that the information gathering power is subject to existing data protection legislation. This means that a person can refuse to supply information under Section 12, which would be a breach of the data protection legislation. I know the Law Society has suggested this statement in the bill might make life more difficult for judicial factors. Do other panel members agree? And is it helpful or unhelpful to judicial factors to emphasise links that would exist between the two pieces of legislation? And I guess for the Law Society, isn't this simply a kind of restatement of the law as it stands?
We'll start with Ms. Ganderson.
Well, I think if I go back to the point that I made about speed being of the essence and all of that, and the fact that judicial factors, their powers and their duties and who they actually are widely misunderstood. So that if you're dealing with, say, an English bank, it might be extremely difficult to get to the right department to get to the funds frozen. And we encounter many times where people use the Data Protection Act as the default position. I can't tell you anything, can't give you any information. Again, we eventually can, you know, get through to the legal team, and the position is, you know, that I am in standing in the shoes of the firm or the individual, I'm entitled to what they, their position is, what information they would be have been entitled to. I think it's just that whole area about giving in the face of the bill a piece of legislation for them to hide behind in the first instance to refuse to give the information as they misunderstand the law, I think might make it more difficult for us to actually operate.
Thank you. And Mr. Lamb?
I'd agree with that. I don't think a restatement of the law as it stands is helpful, and the misunderstandings among those with whom we are interacting as to whether the Data Protection Act applies or not are very unhelpful. Anything that can cut through that is to be commended.
Thank you. And Mr. Petula.
Yes, I entirely agree with that. Data protection is often thrown back at us whenever we submit a request to whoever it might be, whether in my capacity as judicial factor or trustee in bankruptcy or liquidator. You know, at the end of the day, we're appointed as officers of the court, so you cannot really hide behind data protection and say, no, I'm sorry, I'm not going to give you that. So I entirely agree it's unhelpful to have that in the legislation.
Okay, thank you. Oliver?
No, I think that's pretty clear. In terms of the point you're making.
Okay, no, thank you. So just before we move on, is it common for judicial factories to be cross-border, and also the cross-border being also certainly within the UK, but also further afield as well? Have you came across that?
Not the ones I've had. I think all the ones I've had have been purely within Scotland. I can't honestly think whether or not they've had any assets out with Scotland. I don't think so is the answer, as far as I recall. But.
Thank you.
Yes, I've had cases where I've had property abroad to that I needed to realise, so that that presents its own challenges of securing that and finding a mechanism to do that. But I've also had situations, as I say, where individuals have opened up English bank accounts in the hope that they would sort of manage to be able to operate almost out with my appointment terms.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Lam?
In my experience, more limited than my colleagues, I think the dramatis personae of the cases have all been located in Scotland and Scottish. In one instance, there are assets in England in the sense that there are banks in which the account is located in England. Nothing particularly dramatic, and we had no difficulty dealing with it.
Okay. So just before I move on to Tim Eagle, just in terms of this legislation, and do you think this legislation will actually aid the work that you do if there are cross-border issues? I know it's a difficult question.
I certainly cannot see it can do any harm anyway. At the moment, the only legislation we have is a couple of paragraphs from an act in Victorian times. This is clearly a much more wide-ranging and up-to-date piece of legislation. As somebody mentioned earlier on, it's going to receive a bit of publicity anyway, at least amongst the legal profession, whether or not it receives much more, much wider publicity. So I think it's entirely a good thing that this legislation is being brought in, and hopefully it will solve any problems which might have arisen in the past.
Okay. So there's certainly a role then for the Scottish Government, if the legislation does pass the process, for the Scottish Government to engage with associations that will have operations elsewhere within the UK and potentially their international counterparts as well. Would that be fair?
Yes.
Yep, absolutely.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Tim Eagle.
Thank you. So just a quick question around qualification requirements. So as it currently stands within the bill, it's basically just a suitable person as the court decides. Do you think there was a couple of comments that came back to say that individuals thought that they should have a specific qualification, such as property mark, when talking about properties? Do you think that it is fair enough just to be a suitable person, and, sort of given some of the information we were hearing this morning about the broadness of a judicial factor, that that's probably useful? But I appreciate your comments on whether you think there should be more explicitness within the law.
I think that probably is suitable. At the end of the day, the court has to be satisfied as to the suitableness or appropriateness of the person who it appoints as judicial factor. Sandy's clearly a lawyer. Mona deals with all the law society, and I'm a professionally qualified person as well, so I cannot really see that there's any other additional qualifications which need to be put in place. What I do for any of the cases I receive, let's say, for example, there is a property which needs to be dealt with, I would then appoint a property person to advise me in relation to that. And if there is investment funds, I would then, I'm clearly not an investment expert, I would appoint an investment advisor to deal with that. And if there are legal matters, I would then appoint a solicitor.
Risk of, he would say that, wouldn't he? I'd say that what me and solicitors like me do in terms of dealing with trusts and estates is very analogous to dealing with judicial factories, certain aspects of it. I'm not in favour of any specific judicial factory qualification, but I think that in practice, accountants and lawyers are generally speaking well suited, and indeed it will be at the discretion of the court. I think Ken's point is very well made, that one is under a duty to obtain advice on areas in which one is uncertain, whether that be marketing, properties, surveying, investment, tax. If one is not a specialist, one ought to be under a duty to get that specialist advice, and indeed have the power to obtain it too.
Yeah, thank you. And Ms. Grandison.
I don't think I've got anything to add beyond what I explained to the committee this morning earlier.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on. There's a question more really for Mona Grandison. So the panel is very much aware, I would imagine, regarding the McClure's solicitor's situation, which ceased trading in 2021, and Jones White were appointed to take over a very substantial volume of casework on trusts, executives and also powers of attorney. And if the McClure's case had been suitable for the appointment of a judicial factor, the committee is interested in how this actually would have operated in practice, given the scale and the nature of the case law that McClure's had. Just to give you an indication, it was estimated that some over 60,000 wills, over, was it 20,000 powers of attorney, and about 18,500 trusts. And so, for example, who would have actually assumed the responsibility for the ongoing work that was required to existing case files in areas such as trusts and executories? And it's presumably certainly challenging for an in-house judicial factor to have expertise in all the specialist areas of legal practice.
So, Convener, as far as this is concerned, obviously, it's I've not got an awful lot that I can add to what I explained earlier this morning. But I think the issue that you're raising is, would an in-house solicitor, an in-house appointment at the Law Society in a case similar to that, would I do that work, or would the team? And, you know, as I said earlier in my evidence, the answer is quite simply no. The point being is that we would need to dispose of the practice to another firm that is operating in the legal sector to allow them to produce, deal with that. But in particular cases, what might happen is it may be split. You know, the disposal of a practice might be split up so that specialists in trust took one part and another firm took, I've done that before, is another firm has taken another part of the business on the management. The important thing is that the member of the public has a professionally regulated firm that can take forward their legal business and provide them with the appropriate guidance, advice and guidance in relation to that. There is always going to be a challenge when there is vast volumes of cases. But as I say, the important thing is to place the business with another regulated firm so that they can move things on as quickly as possible for the clients of the business.
No, thank you. So just on that point, would it be quite a common thing just to potentially divide up the existing business to other firms if they're also regulated firms?
I have done that in the past because, you know, somebody will come along and say, I'll take your wills and your trust stuff, but I don't want the general chamber practice. I don't do litigation work. I don't do this. So it's more difficult for the members of the public because getting them to the right people is more difficult to get them to understand why their stuff is with this firm as opposed. So it's not always the preferable option, but it's just on the basis of what firms are willing to assist and take on in these situations.
Okay. So just one final question just in this area. If there were, for talking sake, multiple firms who had came forward to offer to assist in a situation akin to what you describe, how would you decide which firm firm or firms should then be basically going to get the work, because for talking segments, say there were two firms that came forward and suggested, well, yeah, we could take the wills. What would be the criteria that the Law Society would look at in terms of, well, we'll give them to firm A before firm B?
So just to be clear, this is, if I am appointed judicial factor, this is not a decision made by the Law Society. This is a decision taken by me as judicial factor. And that would just be based on what the offering was from the various firms. So it would, it's not always going to be a commercial matter, you know, in the sense of the amount of money put on the table by you know, acquiring firm. It may just be ensuring that the proper resource is going to be put into getting it, and the details of the arrangements that are made. And in all of this, I would seek advice and guidance from the accountant of court about, you know, what overall looks like in the best interests of the estate and in the best interests of the clients of the estate. So it's balancing all these competing priorities.
Okay. No, thank you. I don't know if the other panellists wanted to submit the initial question. Yeah. I don't think you would, but I thought I'll give you the opportunity. Okay. Okay, thank you. Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, convener. One policy argument supporting the change of approach to cation in Section 5 of the bill is that where a professional is appointed to the role, professional indemnity insurance provides a suitable alternative to obtaining a specialist bond of cation. Does any of the panel want to comment on whether the scope of their professional indemnity cover protects those with an interest in the estate to the same extent as a bond of cation?
I'm not clear that the professional indemnity carried by the society for these matters does fully cover the estates where, you know, if I had stolen the money in the estate, which is obviously what the bond of cation does. But the point about it is in any case, even if cover were available for the estate, it's still a liability of me and my estate personally that comes back to, if it is theft, it's still the responsibility lasts. Comes back to my estate.
And Mr. Petullo?
Well, certainly my firm's professional indemnity goes up to £30 million, so it would massively exceed any amount of cation. So I think, to be honest, the cation has always seemed to me a slightly odd sort of thing. The most recent one I had was the cation was over several thousand pounds, and that had to be renewed every single year. Which again just seemed a complete waste of money and, you know, a bit of a gravy train for the insurance industry, to be honest. I'm not sure whether or not they've ever actually paid out on any of these bonds of cation anyway, but certainly professional indemnity would absolutely more than adequately cover any amount of cation.
Mr. Lamb?
You may have noticed that I'm very fond of making analogies to other areas of legal practice, and it is a requirement for guardians of incapable adults under the Adults with Incapacity Act, be they professionals or lay people, to obtain cation in respect of the guardianship, financial guardianship, I should say, estate under their care. It's also similarly a requirement for executors' dative, that is, executors appointed by the court, where there is no will, to obtain cation. It seems to me that a judicial factor obtaining cation is broadly analogous to either of those points, although Ken's point about the cost is well made. The market for bonds of cation is not as I understand it, terribly well developed. There are a few big players, but not many. It is a costly exercise. My view is that it ought to be at the discretion of the court. If that is the case, then one would expect the court to take a sensible view based on the availability of professional indemnity cover or otherwise to the intended judicial factor.
Emery, the last judicial factory I had, there were only one or two insurance companies prepared to provide that bondification anyway. So I mean, it's effectively either a monopoly or a duopoly, which never ever is good for competition. So.
Okay, thank you.
So, did you just say that that was never paid, or nobody ever?
Only one or two insurance companies prepared to provide that that cover in the first place, so effectively you pretty much had to pay whatever they demanded, and there was no real competition from any other insurance companies. As Sandy says, you know, there aren't very many of these types of things around anyway, so why on earth should they bother to compete with any other insurance provider? To give you an idea, as I mentioned, the majority of what I do is insolvency, bankruptcies and company and liquidations. The premium for something like that would be about £6 or £10 as opposed to several thousand pounds, and it's not renewed every year. That's for the lifetime of the case. So if the case lasts for 10 years, that bond stays in place for 10 years.
Thank you. And Bill Kidd.
Yeah. Thank you. And sort of continuing on in, somewhat in this vein, in response to this committee's call for views, the Faculty of Advocates said it would be desirable to give the judicial factor the additional power to seek directions from the appointing court. And when the Commission gave evidence to this committee, it suggested that the possibility of seeking advice from the accountant, coupled with the opinion of requesting extra powers from the court under Section 11, was all that would be required. Now, do you agree with the Commission's position on this issue, or do you see benefits to what the faculty is proposing here? And if you wish, you can explain your views with reference to any practical examples of relevant situations.
Mr. Lam?
Yes, I think the judicial factor ought to, as suggested, in conjunction with the accountant of court, be in a position to seek directions or indeed additional powers from the appointing court. Yes, I think that's absolutely necessary and relevant. In a matter with which I'm dealing, that has become necessary simply because the matter in question is so open-ended as to require some fairly significant decisions to be taken as to the future of the assets, and it's unclear as to whether my role as judicial factor, whether I have the relevant power to actually carry out what is proposed.
Ms. Grandison.
I don't really think I have anything further to add from what I said this earlier on this morning.
Good. Mr. Petullo.
Yes, I agree. I can't see any harm in having that in there as a power, the power to apply to court if there is something that comes up that which, you know, for whatever reason the judicial factor does not think he can properly make a decision on without the approval of the court.
Fair. Okay. I mean, that actually means that everyone's working in conjunction rather than battling against each other and for decisions, so that seems perfectly fair. Now, just going on to section 17 of the bill, that covers the investment power for a judicial factor in respect of the estate. Would you be comfortable as a judicial factor making environmental, social and governance ESG investments relating to the estate, or would you require an express statement in legislation that this should be permitted?
I think I would prefer an express statement in the legislation. My kind of impression of the, or my sort of general impression anyway, is that judicial factors, like anyone else dealing with this, would probably be bound to try and achieve the best possible investment returns. And as I mentioned before, if I was appointed as judicial factor and there were funds to invest, I would take the advice of an investment advisor anyway. So I think if those sort of ESG things were to be put in, then I think it would be preferable to have that specifically stated, that that should be an option.
Thank you. Mr. Lamb?
On the one hand, I don't think there should be any specific restrictions on investment. Therefore, I'm not sure that any specific allowance of any particular category is appropriate. If you're going to allow a judicial factor to invest in any investment that a natural person could invest in, then you know, you don't have to say, well, you're allowed this particular category. And I think, as I mentioned before, I would be very much in favour of anyone generally, but particularly a trustee, a fiduciary, or a judicial factor, or you know, anyone who is in that position, obtaining advice. Again, where a financial guardian is looking after an incapable adult's finances, the Office of the Public Guardian has a requirement that if funds cross a particular threshold, that financial advice is taken. That ought to be, I think, the case for judicial factors. If there are funds which require to be invested for a relevant length of time, advice ought to be taken. And the power for judicial factors to take advice, if then that financial advice includes, stick it into ESG investments or whatever, then that's the financial advice. That's what the factor should be doing. I personally, if I were advising a judicial factor or a trustee, I would not be saying to them, you make some decisions on what's going to be invested, whether that be environmental, social, or anything. I would say you need to get professional advice on these investments.
And Ms. Anderson.
Well, I gave evidence on behalf of the Law Society earlier, but I have to say my view as a factor is that this is a prescriptive matter, which if it was introduced to the Act, will not necessarily future-proof the legislation. It's likely to be in a judicial factory case that the factor can go and look at the Trust and Succession Act and say that they can follow the guidance within there, that fiduciary duty of a factor. They can look to other areas. They can go to the account of court and seek guidance with all of that, and of course take independent investment advice and weigh up the benefits of that. But remembering that the Act as a whole envisage many different types of cases, and few of them will probably end up having long-term investment decisions being made in the estates. I think following the guidance of an independent financial advisor is really the only course in general for a factor to go down safely. And as I say, I kind of worry about why is it talking about this type of investment and not something else? And it's when I'm talking about future-proofing, I'm sort of meaning on the basis, I think it's important to take away from legislation things that are currently the norm. One of the concerns I have in the drafting of the new bill is, you know, it talks about share certificates and cash accountings and all the rest of it. And whilst that might have been relevant when this was all being considered, 20 years ago, what it doesn't have. It doesn't talk about cryptocurrencies and non-fungible tokens and digital wallets and all these sorts of things, which we didn't think about, you know, 20 years ago when we were thinking these weren't in existence. So it's my concern about future-proofing the bill, about talking about very, very specific matters, I think is potentially dangerous.
Just on the back of that then, do you think that the average judicial factor, or factory, bigger fund, and we have actually talked about this earlier about how long some of these can actually last, but do you think that the average judicial factory lasts long enough that there needs to be concern about the nature of the kind of investments that might be, because you have actually brought in that there's new kinds of investment that might not have been thought of before, but will some of these judicial factories last long enough to actually have to be concerned, even although they weren't there at the start of their role?
I think this all goes back to what is the nature of the appointment. You know, the appointments that I take on are about getting the assets in and distributing to the people that are entitled to the assets. It's not a long-term hold. But obviously, the charity's situation might be different because they have an investment portfolio to provide for the future for the charitable purposes. It's the same in trust charity judicial factories. If there's been a trust and there are investments. So it's kind of the point about this act is it gives a broad framework for the management of judicial factories, regardless of what the appointment is. It's for the judicial factor on that type of case to look at what the long-term investments or not as part of their management and in discussion with the account of court.
And Mr. Lamb?
One of the features of obtaining independent financial advice typically is, and one of the questions and the scope that financial advisors will want to know is, how long are you intending on investing for? So that's dealt with. The question of whether putting something in for a relevant length of time is going to be that's going to be addressed if one is taking advice, and the advisor, financial advisor, will then tailor their response to the answer. So it's very much context specific, and it will very much depend on, as has been said, what the purpose of the appointment of the judicial factor is for.
Mr. Patoli, you got anything to add?
I think I've said everything I want to say on that.
Well, thank you. Thank you all very much. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. And Tim Eagle.
Yeah, thank you. This came up this morning, actually, Ms. Granderson. So I know you've given an answer to this already, but it was just a quick question around a potential for a complaints procedure within the Act. So there were some submissions that sort of said, in the event that something were to go wrong, in the first sort of recourse to that would be to the accountant, but then thereafter, could there potentially be a complaints procedure within the Act? Do you have feelings or thoughts on that yourselves?
Granderson first.
I think I've highlighted my view at the earlier evidence session as far as that's concerned.
Mr. Patel.
Yeah, I think I would probably not be particularly keen on that. The accountant of court can obviously deal with any complaints. If there are any subsequent complaints after that, then, Sandy and I, for example, and Mona as well, you know, we're all professional people. A complaint can very easily be made to a professional body, and I'd be loath to kind of encourage a complaints charter, if you want to call it that, by simply including that in the legislation. There's no other legislation that I'm aware of that says you can complain to such and such. You know, it just happens if somebody wants to make a complaint, they will find a way to make a complaint.
Mr. Lamb.
Yes, I'd agree. I think that professionals are regulated. They have regulators with complaints procedures, The accountative court, ought, if they are to be the supervisor for judicial factors, ought to be the forum for any complaints about judicial factors specifically. I think with that and the ability of the accountative court to go to the court as well, I don't see any need for any additional complaints procedure.
Just to follow up on that just a wee bit then, I guess, in terms of your own work as a judicial factors, have you come across a case before where, or does it happen very often where that complaint does happen? And I suppose for yourself, where you are doing an investigatory role as well as a judicial factor role, like, I suppose what we want to know is, does that happen very often? Do you get to the point where actually things break down to such an extent that actually complaints are coming in, or actually is that such a rarity that it's not really a concern?
I've had numerous complaints made about things that I have and have not done by parties with interest, and it's been resolved through the process of the matters being referred to the account of court. And indeed, last year I had a case where it was taken to the court as well, so that the process works. Not by the accountant of court, can I hesitate, but that the individual had taken it in opposing my discharge by complaining that I had not done a specific matter. I have to reassure the committee I was judicially discharged, and the court were quite happy with all my actings, but the mechanisms work as they exist, as I see it, and people have the ability to take, if they have an interest in the estate, take things forward.
Okay.
And Mr. Lamb?
Yes, I don't think I have anything more.
Thank you. And Mr. Patil?
I don't want to tempt fate, but I've so far not yet had any complaints about the judicial factors I've dealt with, although I'm conscious Morna obviously deals with more of them than I do, and plus also deals with effectively lawyers who will be quite ready to complain, dare I say it, if things go against them.
Okay. I know you wouldn't come in, Faisal, but I think your area of questioning has been already covered. Yeah. So, colleagues, any further questions for the panellists? Okay, panellists, are there any further points that you would like to highlight that haven't been touched upon this morning? No. Okay. So, with that, I'd like to thank the panellists for coming along to the session this morning. And certainly, if there is anything further that you would like to make the committee aware of after today, if you can please do so in writing. And with that, I will suspend the meeting to allow the panellists to leave. So thank you very much. Under agenda item number three, we're considering an instrument subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft Scottish Tribunals, List of Tribunals, Regulations 2024. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yeah.
Under agenda item number four, we're considering instruments subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSIs 2024, 86 and 102. Is the committee content with these instruments? Yes,
just to make a wee comment on that, I'm very content, and I'm not sure of the exact remit of the committee, but I just wanted to say, as we said earlier on today, just around the fees and how they've been set and whether that could provide a barrier to export. Now, whilst that's not in the jurisdiction of this committee, is that something that we could write back to the substantive committee just to highlight as a potential concern, or is that not within our remit?
Certainly maybe we could raise that point with the League Committee.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So is the committee content with these instruments? Yes. Thank you. So that now concludes the public part of the meeting, and I'll move the committee into private.